Amen. Well, good morning, church. I hope you're ready for some heart surgery and soul repair this morning. Amen. Well, always excited to be able to share the word of God this morning and just waiting and trusting what God would have us hear from the throne room. I believe, and even as I came up earlier this morning, this morning service is something different. I believe that we are here to tear down and uproot strongholds this morning. Our hearts, our minds, in our nation. But God wants to shift something in you this morning so that you can shift atmospheres. Amen. And so will you just allow me the privilege, bear with me this morning. I may take a bit of time. I'm going to try and slow down. I'm saying, Lord, help me to slow down this morning because I really need you to get this message and leave with the revelation that you need to. Pastor Ash did an amazing series on building the temple, and Pastor Laurel touched a little bit on that last week, and she spoke into the battlefield of the mind. And this morning, I want to speak a little bit into the area of that battle. If you didn't know, you are actually in a battle. Every day, we face a battle. We wake up to a battle. And some of us are actually unaware that we are in a battle, and there is an ongoing battle that is actually targeted towards us. And so we don't choose to engage in it because we don't know about it and we become ignorant to it. So we live life actually under fire daily, not realizing that we are being attacked by the enemy, who's the devil. And the biggest lie the devil has on many of people is to believe that he actually doesn't exist, that he's a figment of our imagination, or perhaps if we just ignore him, he'll go away. But that's not the truth. Sitting in and talking in many counseling sessions and just speaking to people, I find that many believers are actually stuck in a limited revelation of their inheritance and believers' authority. Or they feel that they are just defeated. And often you find it's because there's a breakdown in the process. So this morning I'm going to attempt to make this a very practical talk because I need you to get this. I need something to shift in you this morning, and I need you to tear down some stuff in your mind so that you can be empowered to face the challenges of life from the heart of God. Pastor Ash in his series, Building the Temple, reminded us that we are made in the image of God, Genesis 1:27, like the Trinity, which is the tripart, the Trinity of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We are tripart beings, being body, soul, and spirit. And we know that the original plan and communion, the original plan that God had for us in the garden was to have communion, to have intimacy. But we know that because of the fall of man, that was actually tarnished, that failed. So if you guys could actually put up the first slide that Pastor Ash had. So we were created as tripart beings, body, soul, and spirit. And when the fall of man happened, our spirit then died. So we were actually dead in our spirit man. But through the finished work of the cross, through redemption of Jesus Christ, because of what Christ did, we are now redeemed. We can enter back into that relationship with God. And the Holy Spirit is now deposited into us as believers. There's a measure of the Holy Spirit in us as believers. And our spirit man, and Pastor Ash spoke about regeneration, okay? Our spirit man then is made alive to Christ, so we can now hear the Holy Spirit. And that communication between the spirit, soul, and body needs to flow. What happens before we come to faith, the control center, or the one that gives directive to our body, is actually our soul. The I want to do this. I need to do this. I can't do this. I can do this. So the I start actually becomes the dictator to the body. But when we come to faith, our spirit, the Holy Spirit, through our spirit, should now become the command center. That's what should actually be giving direction to our soul, which then gives directive to our body, how we should act and how we should behave. Okay, are you with me so far? Romans 10:9 says that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. The process of living out our life has now been altered when we come to faith. And the control center now shifts from the soul to the spirit. And the Holy Spirit now wants to lead us. Romans 8:14 says, for those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. So where does the heart and brain fit into this process? Can you guys show me slide number 3? I believe that the heart now becomes the bridge between the spirit and our soul. And our physical brain becomes the bridge between our soul and our body. So this is what happens. The Holy Spirit, when we come to faith, we receive a measure of the Holy Spirit. Into our spirit, we're connected, we can hear God. Yes, you can hear God when you come to faith. Some of you still don't believe that you can hear God. God speaks and he wants to speak to you. Okay? He starts working in softening our heart so that he can start working with our soul, which is our mind, will, and emotions, and start leading us to start changing our behavior. But what starts to happen is that we can become stubborn. We have a hard heart, and we close ourselves off to what God has to do and wants to do in us. Are you with me so far? I want to go beyond just the heart this morning, and I want to deal specifically with the soul and the aspect of the mind. Okay? Romans 7 19 through to 23 says, I want to do what is good, but I don't. And this is Paul speaking. I don't want to do what is wrong, but I do it anyway. But if I do what I don't want to do, I'm not really the one doing wrong. It is sin living in me that does it. I have discovered this principle of life, that when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what is wrong. But there's another power within me that is at war with my mind. This power makes me a slave to the sin that is still within me. That sounds a little bit like me. Does it sound a little bit like you sometime? Like I want to do some things that's right, but I feel like I can't do it. And I really know what's right, but I don't end up doing it. But I really want to do it. Why is that? Why is it that we actually know what we should be doing? What is the truth? What is the right thing to do? But our behavior is actually contrary to what the truth of God's word is. There's actually a breakdown in the process of what the Holy Spirit is saying to us and directing our spirit, which then operates and goes through our heart and deals with our mind, will, and emotions to actually change that behavior. And this morning, I'm highlighting more about the mind because I believe that that's where the stronghold in most of our lives is. It's the way we think. I'm going to give you a practical example of how this process actually works. And I'm trying to be very practical and may seem simple, but sometimes simplicity is the way that actually a revelation unlocks and the light bulb goes on in our lives. Amen? So for example, the Holy Spirit is leading you to serve for ushering. Now you can't usher. You've never been there. You've never done this before. Okay? So you're saying to yourself, I can't usher. I'm actually going to have to engage with people. And then you say to yourself, I'm not really good at speaking. My English is not so great. Like, I really have a problem getting the words out. I'm terrified. I'm terrified of people. People are actually going to see my flaws. They're going to see that I trip and fall sometime. Like, you know, they're going to see that my skin is not so good. They're gonna see that I have anxiety sometime. How am I gonna serve? What happens if somebody identifies me and knows my past and I'm gonna be ushering? Only perfect people usher. These are the thoughts that are going through your head. You got to have it all together. You got to be perfect to Asha. Sure, this is too much. And all these things are racing through your mind of why you can't be obedient to what the Holy Spirit is telling you. And those thoughts you start to ponder on in and out. And what happens is that you actually start to empower that lie. And that lie then starts to influence your emotions. And we start to then start feeling shame. We start to feel defeated. Yeah, really, I can't do this. Yes. Now, why did I even think that? I'm inadequate. And we start to agree with the lie that we can't do it. And instead of being obedient to the instruction the Holy Spirit gives us and fill out the form, it gets derailed in the soul. That means our mind and our emotions has derailed and nullified the instruction, the command, the leading the Holy Spirit has given us. And instead of filling out the form, we take it and crush it and throw it in the bin thinking, how dare I even think about doing something like that? Another example. Maybe there's a particular behavior you're struggling with. We sing that song like we've been singing for over the past 2 weeks prior to this. Something has to break. And the Holy Spirit is showing you this particular addiction, this particular thing. He's nudging on something that you're struggling with. And instead of saying to the Holy Spirit, or yielding to that voice and saying, God, what is the root? You silence it and say, no, can't be. No, I'm not going to deal with that. I'm going to start to confess my sin. I'm going to start confessing that I have a weakness. I'm going to start talking about addiction and a cycle that I've been in. I'm going to talk about my weaknesses. No, I can't do that. Because that's going to start working on my identity. And I've had to be like this for so long. I'm comfortable being dysfunctional. I'm comfortable dealing with it. I'm comfortable being in the cycle of brokenness and having less than. I'm comfortable with my little issue that I have and my little behavior and my little thing that I've got going on, and nobody knows about it. And instead of yielding to what the Holy Spirit is saying, in your soul, in your mind, you've already negated that. And you said, no. I don't want. Instead of asking, what is the root, God? What is the root to the behavior? Because all our behaviors are rooted in something. It's rooted in a belief. It's rooted in a thought. Where does anxiety stem? It's an emotion which results in a behavior, which is actually rooted in a lie, in something that you believe to be true. Sometimes we live our lives on a lie, and we live it as if it's truth. You get this? We're living our life so like, I believe this, and it's truth in my world, but it's actually a lie. And when you actually look at the root of that anxiety, the root of that fear, it's contrary to who God says you are. It's contrary to God's truth. So instead of letting the Holy Spirit and our heart, the Holy Spirit to lead us and allow our hearts to be softened to what God is doing, we then block out what God wants to do. So why is it that we know God's promises? Why do we know the truth? And some of us know from Genesis to Revelation, and we can quote scripture upon scripture, but we're not living it out. We're living less than what God has for us. And I sit there and I think to myself, God, I'm not a believer so long, and there's people sitting around me that are believers longer than I. Why is it that they are sitting less and experiencing less than what you have for them? Some of them are not fulfilling the purpose. Some of them are living in dysfunctional homes as believers, in marriages, in environments in their lives, in their moral scales, contrary to the word of God? Why is it as believers, some of them think it's okay to be engaged and having sex when you haven't been married yet? Why hasn't the truth penetrated to my body so my behavior is in line with what the word of God says? Something has been broken. Where has the process broken? Is it because my heart has been so hardened by the things of life, by the situations, by the pain? Is it because my mind hasn't been renewed enough by the truth of what God says? Romans 8, 6 to 7 says, "So letting your sinful nature control your mind leads to death, but letting the Spirit control your mind leads to life and peace. For the sinful nature is always hostile to God. It never did obey God's laws, and it never will." To change how we behave, how we respond, we have to change how we think. Bill Johnson says this: "Our thinking should be consistent with his nature. We should be thinking in line of what we learned about the nature of God. God is good. Our thoughts of who he is should be good thoughts about him, because he is good." Come on, tell your neighbor, God is good. Not just sometime, all the time. Amen? Craig Rochelle says this: "Our lives move in the direction of our strongest thoughts." And I'm going to say that again this morning. Our lives move in the direction of our strongest thoughts. So if our thinking is warped, we're walking in the wrong direction. How we think is so important. Romans 12, 2 says this: "And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." I'm going to break this down. Okay. Be transformed, okay, in your mind, so that you can walk and know the good, perfect, acceptable will of God. If I am not walking in the good, acceptable, and perfect will of God, where's the problem? In my mind. That means a renewed mind should see me walking in the good, perfect, and acceptable will of God. This is where the problem is our mind. This is where the limitation comes in us walking in the revelation that God gives us and being obedient to what God calls us, because our mind says no. Our mind is filled with lies and not enough of God's truth. How we think is so important because our thoughts create neurochemical change in our mind. And I'm no neuroscientist or psychologist, but I love studying this stuff because I think it just is so intriguing to understand actually how science proves the Bible and vice versa. Sometimes we think, oh, science only kills the thing. No. When you actually read it, you're like, yes, yeah, God said that in the Word. Look at this. He's doing it. Amen? Let me say that again. So our thoughts create neurochemical change in our mind, and your brain literally redesigns itself around that thought. So neurons linked together create messages, and the same message sent repeatedly creates neural pathways. That's what I want to zone in today. Neural pathways. What Romans 12:2, some versions say, "And do not be conformed to this world," the pattern of this world. Those neural pathways are patterns that are being created. So let me break this down. Every time we have a thought, Okay? There's messages that are created, and every time we think that thought, it creates a pathway. So what happens? Every time we think the same thing, we're actually kind of reinforcing, trenching that. So an example of this is, you travel the same way home every day. Comes a point, you don't have to think much about which way you got to go, right? You like naturally dive this side, turn right, turn left. And that's what can happen with us. When we have these negative thoughts, we're so used to thinking negative or feeding ourselves on the lies that we don't even awaken ourselves to the truth to what God is saying. We keep ourselves in the pattern of negative thinking, of believing the lies that the enemy, and we don't shift to God's truth. Philippians 4, you see, there were patterns. Sorry, before I get to that scripture, there was patterns before we came to faith of the way we think. That comes from your family, comes from culture, comes from life experiences, etc. It's the way we think. It's the patterns we already created in our minds. It's mindsets that we have already shaped. But when we come to faith, those things need to change. And what changes that? The truth of God's word by the Holy Spirit. Those patterns need to change. Philippians 4, 8 to 9 in the Message says this. Summing it all up, friends, I say, you'll do best by filling your minds and meditating on things true, noble, reputable, authentic, compelling, gracious, the best, not the worst. The beautiful, not the ugly things to praise, not things to curse. Put into practice what you've learned from me. And this is Paul. What you heard and saw and realized, do that. And God, who makes everything work together, will work you into his most excellent harmonies. This is the guy that we read about before that says, I like to do, I know what is good, I like to do what's good, but I don't find myself doing it. That's the guy. But there's a shift in the scripture later on when it sounds like he kind of got it together later in the word. It says that there's a scripture, it says, I know how to abase, I know how to abound, I know how to be content. No matter what I face, I know that God is with me. Just paraphrasing that. But there's a shift in his mind. What is the shift? What happened to Paul? I believe he gives us the keys there in Romans. It's a renewed mind. So how do I stop this war that happens in our mind? Because that's the war. It's above our eyebrows. It's here. Every time God says something or the truth of God comes to you, there's a warring here. Is this true? Can I? So when the Holy Spirit is saying something, or God is leading you to do something, the war up here is the war between the lies that you've known and the truth of God's word. So I can do all things with Christ who strengthens me is now having to war with the lie that says, no, you can't speak properly. What about your past? No, you can't. You forgot what they said to you the last time? You forgot the pain they caused you the last time? No, you can't. That's the war that's happening. Come on, are you with me? Are you with me this morning? Is this helping somebody? I hope it is. Because this is where our strongholds are. The dictionary defines a stronghold in coming to battle is the area, it's a fortified city. Okay, when it comes to the battle, when it talks about the battles and it refers to a stronghold, a fortress, it says it's a fortified area in the city. It was a high place. And in that place, they would hide the politicians or the rulers or the people that were in charge. And then that would be the last place. But when it's taken, if it is not taken down, that city will reestablish itself. That means if we don't deal with the strongholds in our mind, the rulers, those dark things, the lies that we have fed ourselves for so long, we will continue to walk in dysfunctionality and say that the Bible does not work for me. This Christian thing is not for me. No, the Bible is true. The walk is not easy, but you can do it through the greater power that's the Holy Spirit. 2 Corinthians 10, verses 3 to 5 says, we are human, but we don't wage war as humans do. We use God's mighty weapons, not worldly weapons, to knock down the strongholds of human reasoning and to destroy false arguments. We destroy every proud obstacle that keeps people from knowing God. We capture their rebellious thoughts and teach them to obey Christ. This sounds like something quite aggressive. This is not saying, oh no, you'll be okay. Just stop thinking that. Just ignore the devil. No, this is saying you need to war. You need to pull down. You need to actually destroy the lies, the stronghold, the arguments, those things that are coming against the truth of God's word, because you have them. And when you start thinking about what you think about, you'll realize that you actually have toxic thinking in certain areas. When you start to take an audit of your thinking and start realizing what is this, what are the things that I'm thinking about and what are they kind of circling on, and if you actually go to the root of it, you'll find out that sometimes those things are actually contrary to the truth of God's word. We are to live by the truth of God's word. That's what guarantees us the victory. Not what I think, what I know to be. No, it's the truth of God's word, because it's the same yesterday, today, and forever. It doesn't change. Amen? So we are actually to cast down. These are violent actions. That means that you need to actually take hold. You need to be aggressive about those things that are tormenting you. The war that's in here, that's saying you can't, that says you won't. You'll never end up being. God is not for you. This is not for you. It's only for some. That's the word that goes in here. It's the thought patterns that you will always be stuck in this. Sometimes when God is leading us to become a generous people and God wants to break us out of depravity and poverty, God is calling us to do something unusual. God is asking us to step out in faith and do something we've never done before. The battle is here saying, man, I can't do that because I won't have enough. This is a good example. And you know why you say that you won't have enough? Not that sometimes you may actually not have enough here. You may have a good bank balance. You may have a lot that you can actually give up. You know why you say, I can't give, I don't have enough? Because when you were little, somewhere your mom and dad said something to you. We can't do this. We don't have enough. We'll never have enough. Make sure that you keep this tight. Don't share. We won't have enough. That seed is bearing fruit when you're sitting here and we sing, the Lord is leading us to give a seed offering. And you're saying, I can never do that. Seed above my tithe, I'll never have enough. And you think to yourself, why am I thinking like this? God, I know you're my provider. God, you are Jehovah. I've seen you do this, God. I've seen you provide food when I didn't have. I've seen you give me a promotion. There's the seed. Uproot that seed. Take it out. Kill the fruit. Declare it. How do you kill it? You uproot. You say, I will not believe that lie. That is a lie. I don't believe that. This is what God's truth is. And you take the lie and you replace it with God's truth. Amen? 2 Corinthians 10, 3:5 in the New King James also say this. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God to the pulling down of strongholds. And so often we're trying to do behavior change. We're trying to change our behaviors in practical ways. Just trying to stop doing this. But it's not about just not doing something physically. It's about how you think. We need to change our thinking to change our behavior. And we can only be renewed in our thinking by God's word. So what are the weapons that we use? The truth, the word of God. Prayer is a weapon. The armor of God is a weapon. Ephesians 6 verse 10, read up on the armor of God. And it says, after putting all these things on, the soldier, the last thing that he actually puts on is the helmet. The helmet of salvation. And when we place the helmet of salvation, it's the truth in the finished work of the cross. It's the revelation of what Jesus has done. Now that I have been saved, I'm a new creation in Christ. It's understanding what you have now received. So it's placing that mindset. It's the new mindset. It's the helmet. I'm protected from the darts because I believe what the finished work of the cross was and what I have as an inheritance because of what Jesus did. The other weapons, the name of Jesus and the blood of Jesus. And so this morning, even as we get ready, our hearts, prepare our hearts to partake of the sacrament of communion, the blood that was shed and the body that was bruised, we take that with the reverence for what Jesus did. But revelation that because of what he did, I can now be all that he has called me to be. I can now walk in the fullness and the purpose that he has called me to walk in. I am a new creation. I can walk in the truth of God's word. I am changed. I'm not the old. I'm not believing the lies anymore because of that finished work. So this morning my prayer is, as you partake, would you partake it from a different angle, a different attitude this morning, with a greater reverence for what he's done, but with a greater revelation of the truth of what you have and you are called to walk in as a believer this morning.